The Lord has been blessing us. And there are more blessings for every one of us. We are going to open our hearts and say, Lord, I surrender. Let us pray. Just that simple statement. And something good will happen to you. Because God wants to have all of you, not just a part of you. Because he loves you. He doesn't want you to spend your eternity in hell. He doesn't want you to labor without being rewarded in his kingdom. You are here because you want him to do something great in your life. Father, we thank you again. We bless your name for this time. We thank you for all that you have been speaking to us. We come before you, Lord, and we say, Lord, we surrender. Like a clay in the potter's hand, we pray you will break us, you will mend us, you will remold us, and you will fill us. We're asking, oh God, that none of us will be a redundant Christian. None of us will be a stagnant believer. As you have touched us, you will use us to touch the lives of other people. Any area of our life where we have not surrendered, we pray the grace and the faith that we need to surrender everything today. Lord, we receive that grace. We receive that faith. As the scripture has said, that from the days of John the Baptist, the kingdom of God suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. Father, we have come to take it by force. Satan will not hinder us. Our flesh will not hinder us. Father, the past will not hinder us. Calvary will move us forward. Your spirit will move us forward. Your grace will move us forward. Where we have failed before, we will succeed. Where we have fallen before, we will rise up and we'll go forward. Father, we will not be a disappointment. Speak to us today, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I know you are happy to be here, and likewise, I'm happy to be here. It's been a wonderful time in the presence of the Lord, and the Lord has been touching every one of us. If your brother is sleeping by your side, your sister is sleeping by your side, I know that you are your brother's keeper, you are your sister's keeper. You don't want your brother, you don't want your sister to miss what the Lord has for us at this moment. Absolute surrendered life. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 is our starting text. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. We must understand the kind of God that we serve. He's a holy God. We can't just bring anything to him and say, hey, take. No, he's showing us the kind of things he wants from you. He's showing us the kind of things he wants from you and from me. He said, the sacrifice I want you to give is a living sacrifice, holy. And look at how solemn the request is, the plea is, I beseech you, therefore, brethren. That means those who are already saved, sometimes you want to make a kind of important request. You don't want to command them. You want them to know the gravity of what you are saying, the consequence of what you are saying, the seriousness of the matter, so that it will go deep and down to the bottom of their being, so that they will not miss it. You know, sometimes an elderly person has an important message. He doesn't shout it. He wants you to keep your ear so close to his mouth so that you can hear that thing. And that's what exactly the Lord is saying, that he is beseeching us that we should present our body. Let me just tell you one thing, why we need to present that body to God. completely, totally, wholly, because the devil is also interested in that body. And of course, in the past, we gave that body to the devil. We used the various members, our hand, our fingers, our ears, our mouth, our leg, to serve the devil. And the devil still wants to have an role. He still wants to operate. He still wants to possess. He still wants to rule. But when we give everything to God, we can gladly say, God, my hand belongs to you. My ears belongs to you. My hand, every part of me belongs to you. There is no reason for the devil to torment, to oppress, to afflict any part of this body, because everything belongs to you. That's exactly why we need to give the whole of our body to God. Absolute surrender. This is a life that is spread out in our verse. Complete, total giving of ourselves to God. That means you are giving the authority of your life to God. It's like you are giving the key of your house. You say, this is the key of my house. Take. God, rule my life. God, control my life. Have your way in my life. It's no longer I, but Jesus. Like Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. This is a life that is presented, yielded, consecrated unto God. When God saves us, he begins to show us how we should live our lives. Some people are saved. They just say, well, I'm born again. I just live anyhow. No, not at all. You cannot live like that. The devil will find you on the way and he will say, well, you don't have any relationship with that God because you are like a city without a wall. He will have, you know, the opportunity to come again. But when that life is given to God, God begins to show us what he has said, what we should avoid, and how we should live to please him all the days of our life. To have the fullness of life means we should absolutely surrender our lives to God and be able to say like Christ, not my will, but thy will be done. We're looking at the message in three parts. Point number one, absolute surrender of our life. Absolute surrender of our life. Rather, exhortation to absolute surrender of our life. Point two, evidence of absolute surrendered life. What are the evidences that we can see or that you can see in your life that, yes, this my life has been given to God. There is no question about it. There is no doubt about it. I know it in my heart. Not because somebody told me, I know it in my heart. That in the past, I gave some part of my body, some part to members of my body to the devil, but now I surrender everything. In the past, I just came to church and just go home, you know, half Christian, half baked, but now I know I surrender everything to Christ. And should the trumpet sound today, by the grace of God, I know I will be there. You want to have that assurance, evidence of absolute surrendered life. And of course, the last point is endurance of the absolute surrendered life. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1, I beseech you, therefore, we are considering the first point, exhortation to absolute surrender of our life. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. You see, the people that are the most target of the devil are those who are believers. The sinners, they are just the children of the devil. So if they die as sinners, they'll go to hell. But for those who have already escaped, you have so much to lose. Should you miss heaven? You have so much to lose. Should you miss being with Christ all eternity? And because of that, the Lord is saying, I want to control of your life. If only you will give it to me. I want to control how you relate at home. I want to control how you do your work. I want to control how you correct people, how you discipline, how you preach, what you tell others, how you apply it to your life. And for that thing to work, you need to let me have all your life. That is what the Lord is saying. He said, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, In the Old Testament, they bring the animal, they lay the animal on the altar, they kill the animal. He said, no, I don't want you to do that. Jesus has finalized that. You are now the sacrifice, but living. Present yourself unto me, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Greek authorities tell us that the verb used here is a strong word and very hard to render into English. It could be translated, I beg you earnestly, I exhort you, I entreat you. It has a deep meaning, as if God Almighty, your creator, my creator. You can see the position of God concerning your life. You can see the position of God concerning my life. That is even saying, don't give me half of you. It's not going to help you. Don't give me only one ear. It's not going to help you. Don't give me half of you, 99%. It's not going to help you. He said, I want everything. Just like we have been hearing. You sing with the mouth. Let that same mouth not curse somebody. You preach it with your mouth. Let that same mouth not speak lie. Let me have it 24/7. That is what the Bible is saying. It has a deep meaning, as if God himself is, we are on his knees before his people, begging them to give themselves unto him. Because, he said, because of his mercy. I plead with you because of his mercy. The question is, what has God's mercy done in your life? Look at the book of Jonah. Jonah chapter 3, verse 4. And Jonah began to enter into the city, a day's journey. And he cried and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. That is true. As sinners, that is the judgment of God on you, on anybody that is a sinner. The soul that sinneth, he shall do what? He shall die. So that's what Jonah was telling the people in Nineveh. Yet 40 days, within a short period of time. Maybe for some people, we don't know how many days. We don't know how many years are left. But the fact of the matter is that not many days. Even if you live 100 years, it shall be well with the righteous, but it shall be ill with the unrighteous. But Jonah said, yeah, 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. Verse 8. But let man, that now the king responded. He said, look, we know this kind of God. He will show us mercy. If we turn to him, that's exactly what happened to you. That day, I don't know where, I don't know when. If you are really born again, that is what happened to you. You turn to him. You say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I'm a wretched man. I've broken your commandment. I made a vow. I took New Year resolution. I will not go this way. I will not go this way. I've done it again. I've disappointed you again. And God said, stop there. I will forgive you. And he forgave you. He wrote your name on the book of life. But can you now go free and say, yes, I'm a free man, I'm a free woman, I can live anywhere how I want to live. I can do. God said, no, if you do that, all that grace I put upon you will be vain. You will have wasted everything. Can you imagine somebody that you travel a long distance, you know, like people that, those of us that come from the countryside, you travel a long distance to the riverside, and then you go to the riverside, you couldn't fetch the water by yourself, and somebody helped you. You got that water on top of your head, and then you were just going home careless and rejoicing. You just left that pot on your head, and you are just, you know, walking anyhow, and the thing fell down and broke. That would be foolish. God said, no, I don't want you to be foolish. I want to keep you because you cannot keep yourself. He wants to keep me because I cannot keep myself. That is the core of absolute surrender. That is the center of absolute surrender. You give every... What? Is there any area that God cannot have his way? Is there any area of our life that God cannot perfect? Marriage, he can perfect it. Business, he can perfect it. Anything, any area of our life. There is nothing that we can put in the hand of God that God will say, hey, look, my son, that is a difficult job for me. I'm sorry, although I made a promise, but I've come to look at it that I can't fulfill this promise. You say you're looking for a wife. I don't know how I can help you. I can't lead you. You know, you're looking for a job. I'm sorry, the society is so difficult. I am sorry, I can't. There is just no area that God cannot help us. I mean, that is why the Bible says we should cast our body, cast everything upon Him. Let Him lead you. Don't keep a path away. If you keep a path away, that path will not be secure. That path will not be protected. That path will not be blessed. Give everything to God. And so what happened to these people? The king said, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn everyone from his evil way. Well, I don't know whether you need to hear it again, but let me say it again. If you have not turned, what are you waiting for? The God of mercy is calling you. He wants to turn you. He wants to take away your sins. He wants to take away your iniquities. He wants to take away your unrighteousness. Those unrighteousness that no eye sees, they see your smile, but they don't know what is behind the smile. He wants to turn away all those things. You don't need to go and taste hell to know how terrible hell is. He knows how terrible hell is. As a matter of fact, we are told that hell is not meant for us. It's for the devil and his angels. And so they turned. When God saw their works, that they turned from their evil ways, God repented of that evil that he had said he would do unto them, and he did it not. Here is the mercy of God in manifestation. Here is the reason why we are exhorted to yield ourselves unto God. God, in his mercy, has forgiven us so great a debt we could never pay. And the least you can do, the least I can do, in a wise way, is to surrender that single life unto God. Only one life. And it will soon be passed. The songwriter says, only what is done for Christ will last. But beyond that, when you give your life to Christ, surrender everything, he is able to keep that which is committed unto him. Look at the book of Matthew chapter 18, the message of God. That's why Paul the apostle is saying, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God. It was not because you were qualified to be forgiven. It's not because I was qualified to be cleansed. It is because of the mercy of God. That the immortal God dies. Jesus died for us. Matthew chapter 18, verse 23. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take account of his servant. Verse 24. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. That is a lot of money. All the good that God had been expecting us to do to him, we have not been doing it. Maybe you just started doing it. But let me ask you, if you just started doing it, how long do you want to do it? For only 1 year? Only 2 years? You want to do it all your life. And to be able to do it all your life, you need to give your whole life. Put your life in God's hand. Like a clay in the hand of a potter. All that you will need, all that we need to be able to perfect his will in our life will be supplied by him. We continue with the parable, verse 24. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. But for as much as he had not to pay, his lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and his children and all that he had, and payment to be made. Verse 26. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him. He fell down and worshipped him. Big man, have you worshipped Jesus? Have you come on your knees? Have you surrendered everything? Or you are looking at your certificate, or you are looking at your account? You are looking at the people that you have blessed with your silver and gold? Have you come down to that level and say, I give myself to you? Or you are looking at your talent? This man fell down, verse 26. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me. Have mercy on me. And I will pay thee all. Verse 27. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him. Somebody say amen. There is forgiveness even now. And once you are forgiven, it is forgotten by God. This is an illustration of the mercy God has showed unto us. Based on this mercy, he's saying to you, surrender your bodies to me. That body that will have been consumed and be burning in hellfire forever and ever, surrender it unto me. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Exhortation to absolute surrender. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you? The first word in that verse is a question. What? Why was he saying what? And that word should be coming to us today. What? Don't you know that your tongue is created by God? What? Don't you know that your ears are made by God? What? Don't you know that your feet are made by God? What? Don't you know that your mind is made by God? Why will you give any part to the enemy when God wants you to give it to him so that he can use it to bless others? He says in verse, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own, for ye are bought with what? With what? You are bought with a price. You are bought with a price. Look at your house, for example, you buy the house. Will you just allow somebody to come and put garbage there, dump something there? No, when you see that, you write a sign, put a sign out there. No trespassing in this place. Trespassers will be prosecuted. That is what you write there. You want to protect that property. God said, look, I bought you with the precious blood of my son. For ye are bought with a price. Therefore, do what? Glorify God in your what? In your body and in your spirit, which are God. If we truly understand what Christ has done for us, if we truly understand what Christ has done for us on the cross of Calvary, I don't think there is any part of us who will want to hold back from him. We will give everything to him just to say, this is the least I can do to be thankful. I want to surrender to God shows how much, number one, how much we love him. That servant in the book of Exodus, after he has served his master that has redeemed him, and the master said, okay, this is the seventh year, go home. He said, no, I love my master. I will remain with my master forever. How much you surrender to him will be based on how much you love him. If you say you love him, you will surrender everything that he asks from you. Number two, it shows how much we understand his will. Do you understand his will? He says surrendering to him is the perfect will of God for every one of us. And then it shows how much we care about his word. How much we love him. How much we know his commandments. And how much we understand his will. Giving God everything that he asks for is called absolute surrender. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do it to the glory of God. Point number two, evidence of the absolute surrendered life. Evidence. The evidence of absolute surrendered life go beyond what we say. Even go beyond what we preach. Even go beyond what we sing. It depends on how we live our life and what we do, both in the public and in the private place. And it depends on what we take to be the priority of our life. What is the priority of your life? The thing that is most important to Christ, is that what is most important to me? Is that what is most important to you? If you say, I surrender all, like we have just heard in the song, but your silver, you will not give it. Your time, you will not give it. You will not give forgiveness. He said, whether you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do it to the glory of God. Jesus said in John chapter 4, verse 34, Jesus said unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. That's an evidence of absolute surrender. Absolute surrender. That is my meat. That is the thing that is most important to me, the will of God. In John chapter 8, verse 28, then said Jesus unto them, when ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father has taught me, I speak these things. And he that sent me is with me, and the Father has not left me alone. We don't want God to leave us alone. But that is not an evidence of absolute surrender. The evidence of absolute surrender is this. I do always. I think that's a weighty part of that verse. I do always. I do always those things that please. That please who? That please who? That please him. You can please a man, but if you do not please the Lord, that is not absolute surrender. There are those that surrender because of fear of man, what the man will say, what the person will say. But absolute surrender is to do everything as pleasing unto God. Evidence of absolute surrender. Number one, that is the grace and the power to always do those things that pleases God. Look at Joseph. Father wasn't there, mother wasn't there, brothers weren't there. But how did he live his life? Absolute surrender. He gave everything to God. In the house of Potiphar, he served so well that the man saw, what, this man, God is with him. Can people really say that about us? This man, God is with him. This woman, God is with her. Because the man surrendered everything. He didn't live in a convenient place. He has reason to be sad and to be sorrowful and to do the work just anyhow and say, well, already I'm a slave. It doesn't matter to me. Father is not here. Mother is not here. Brothers are not here. So who cares about me? If God cares about me, God will have delivered me. No, that man has surrendered everything to God. He knew that the dream that God has given him, the time will come when that dream will become fulfilled. You know, some of the good dreams or some good dreams that people have, the dream don't come true, not because God has become unfaithful, because along the way, they themselves are no longer faithful. They don't surrender in hard times. Some people surrender when everything is good. They surrender when the sun is shining because they wanted the sun to shine. The rain is falling because they wanted the rain. But if they wanted rain and the sun is shining, they will not surrender. If they wanted sun and the rain is falling, they will not surrender. If they wanted food and there is no food, they will not surrender. If there is delay, they will not surrender. They will take everything. If somebody said that the problem with living sacrifice is that he had the tendency to crawl away from the altar. You lay yourself on the altar and say, God, forever on the altar. But when difficulties come your way, you say, I don't think I actually said I will surrender everything to God. And maybe it was in a dream. I'm not sure it was in reality. So God, in any case, it wasn't in reality. So I will think about it because the going is hard. You know, but when you are surrender yourself, you lay yourself on the altar forever for God. Amen? Amen? I pray that this day we will surrender completely to God in Jesus' name. So that is what the Lord is telling us. evidence of absolute surrendered life. Two, there is delight to do the will of God. That is an evidence. If you had a delight to do the will of God, not when it pleases, even when it doesn't please you, when it's not comfortable, I mean convenient, there is a delight to do the will of God. Like Noah building the ark, following all the detailed patterns without questioning God. What do you think about Noah? That man was a surrendered man. He did everything according to what he was told. Genesis chapter 2, chapter 6, verse 22, and chapter 7, verse 5. Number 3, by the grace of God, our life, this is an evidence, our life is free from being stumbling blocks. If your life is still a stumbling block to the people that want to get to heaven, that means that life has not been completely surrendered unto God. Of Daniel, they said, we have tried him in the King of Kings business, no blemish, no spot. We have tried him in the secular business, no blemish, no spot. That is an evidence of absolute surrender. We follow him to his church, no blemish, no spot. We follow him to his place of work, no blemish, no spot. That is an evidence of absolute surrender. It doesn't mean that as a worker, you go about your workplace preaching every minute. Say, thus says the Lord, you must repent. No, it means we serve faithfully and honestly, number one, as unto the Lord. It means we preach the gospel by performing our duties well. We are not frivolous. We are not dodging our job. We are not neglecting our job. We do it as unto the Lord. And people can read Christ in what we do. Number 4, we do the will of God at every opportunity. Evidence number 5, we resist temptation both in the private and in the public. Like Joseph, how can I do this? I sin against my God. Number 6, we do the will of God even under difficult situation. Number 7, we live for Christ and not for self. Look at Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6 of men that surrender unto Christ, that surrender their selves. Acts chapter 6, verse 4. But we give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Do you know a man called Levi in the Bible? He became one of the apostles. Jesus called him, follow me. The Bible says he left all. Do you know why some of us were performing below expectation? Because there are some certain things we have not given all. Some of them, they are just things that don't really matter. In eternity, it doesn't matter. Even right now, it doesn't really matter. But we allow those things to tie us down. Number 8, evidence. We rejoice at Christ's salvation, whatever the challenges of life. Do you remember Paul? You remember Silas? Beaten with many stripes? Locked up? In prison for doing no evil, for serving the holy God, preaching to men that they should repent, cast out devil from that girl, and they were beaten. Do you know what they did? They still rejoice. They still sing praises to God. I don't know what you are going through. Can you sing when it is darkest? Can you sing and praise God and still come to church? That is an evidence of absolute surrender. Absolute surrender. Praising God in difficult situations. Number 9, steadfast conviction. No matter the environment we find ourselves, as we examine ourselves this day, can we notice evidence of absolute surrender? Have you left all to follow Christ and Christ alone? Have you surrendered all to Jesus? Today, you need to be sure that you have surrendered your life unto God. Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. Finally, endurance of the absolute surrendered life. You know, it is easy for you to endure when you know that truly, honestly, that you have surrendered everything to God. By the way, how will God perfect that which concerns you if you don't surrender everything about your marriage, about your family, about your business, whatever you are doing? If you don't surrender everything, how will God perfect that which concerns you? In the book of Psalm chapter 138, verse 8. Psalm 138, as we round up in a few minutes. 138, verse 8. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. But why has he not perfected all that concerns our life? Because some, like the clay, they are not yielding themselves totally in the hand of the potter. But when we yield ourselves completely and totally, God will perfect that which concerns our life. I say we perfect that which concerns our life. Every gift of God, salvation is a gift, sanctification is a gift, Holy Ghost is a gift, is provided to make us more like Christ. The graces that come through these Christian experiences are meant to perfect us and help us to endure to the very end. Paul said in Acts chapter 20, verse 24. 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 But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish. Amen. How many of us want to finish the Christian race? What you need to do, what I need to do, is to allow the Lord to carry every part of you. Imagine if it were possible for one hand, you split this, take it this way, put another hand this way. I mean, already you are becoming complete. If the hand is separated from the body, the leg, another leg is separated from the body, that person has become incomplete. If the head gets to that place, but the hand is not there with the leg and with the head to be able to write, how will we be able to guess what you are looking for? So for us to be able to make it to the end, we need to surrender everything. In fact, that will increase our boldness on the throne of grace. When we come to pray, that is absolute surrender. Everything, we lay it before the Lord. And when we do that, knowing that there is nothing in the world that will make us to turn back, then we'll be able to make it to the end. In fact, in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 4, Moses said, all of you that cleave unto the Lord, you are alive. What kept them alive? Because they cleave unto the Lord. And my time is almost gone, but let me quickly turn to Ruth. This is an important part before we pray. I think I have two references, Ruth and then 1 King. But let's turn to Ruth quickly. Ruth chapter 1. Ruth chapter 1. We know the story of Ruth. But let's see what happened in her life. How she made it from Moab to Bethlehem, Judah. Because you and I were on a journey. Ruth chapter 1 verse 15. And she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back from her people and unto her God. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, entreat me not, beg me not, do not tell me. Entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more so, if aught, but death part thee and me. when she saw, that is Ruth, when she saw that, I mean Naomi, when she saw that Ruth was steadfastly minded, I use steadfastly minded to go all the way, minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her, so they two went. I don't know how long the journey was, but the journey ended well. I pray our Christian journey will end well. So they two went until they came to Bethlehem. To Bethlehem. I pray we will arrive heaven safely in Jesus' name. The more we surrender to God, the more we find Him sufficient to support us, to strengthen us, and to keep us. He told Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you." His grace is sufficient for us. All Christ's disciples can fully surrender to Him. For God never requests us to do what is impossible. Paul said, He gives us the grace. It is God that gives us the strength to do what He's commanding us. Think about this. What a powerful life you and I will live. What a peaceful life you and I will enjoy. What victory we will experience and what unity we will see in the church. And what great testimony we will bring to the world around us. If every father that says he is born again, if every mother that says she is born again, if every child that says he or she is born again, completely surrender their lives unto God. That is why he's saying, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye surrender unto me. Before we pray, 1 Kings chapter 20. I read quickly 1 Kings chapter 20, and then we shall pray. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 1. Abinadab, the king of Syria, gathered all the host together, and there were 32 kings with him, and horses and chariots, and he went up and besieged Samaria and war against it. And he sent messengers to Ahab, king of Israel, into the city, and said unto him, Thus says Abinadab, Thy silver and thy gold is mine, thy wives also and thy children, even the goodliest are mine. And the king of Israel answered and said, My lord, O king, according to thy saying, I am thine and all that I have. Will you surrender all to Jesus today? That will cause joy in your life. That will be the secret of fulfillment of life. The riches of God's mercy lies on the path of those that surrender all to Jesus. Can you say by faith, to Jesus I surrender? Let's bow our heads and pray. I want you to talk to the Lord. Just surrender right now. It doesn't take time. Say, Lord, I surrender. You need not to struggle with Him because you will break yourself. Just say, Lord, I give my heart to you. I give my soul to you. A simple prayer like that can go a long way. You have longed for sweet peace and faith to increase and have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. If you pray in faith, I'm sure God has answered our prayer. Father, we thank you today. We give you glory for speaking to us, calling us to surrender our bodies unto you for your use here on earth. And so, Lord, we come again in obedience to your word, and we say, Lord, we surrender. We are not going to hold back anything because you owe us. And so, Lord, we pray that you will take all of us and use us for your glory. Anything that has been holding us back, we command that they be broken from our life this day. Change everything that needs to be changed. Glorify yourself in every one of our life. And use every one of us to the glory of your name, dear Lord. We thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said,